well. Amen. How are you excited about hearing the word of the Lord? Amen. I want to hear the word of the Lord tonight. We're going to ask for the Caraway to come and preach to us. I was prayerfully considering about who to have speak at this event. We've always had our local guys preach this. They've done a fantastic job. This year I felt like the Lord was leading toward bringing somebody in to speak. Prayed about it. Brother Caraway's name is given to me. I just was instantly the right person. So we're very excited to have him here tonight to preach. And we have a connection. Both of our grandfathers have pastored West Monroe Apostolic Church. It's a very small club. Very small club. We do a lot of fun. Amen. If you would, why don't you put your hands together? Let's give a clap of appreciation to Caraway. Let's do it under the Lord, shall we? Do you love the Lord? Do you love God? I love him, don't you? Amen, 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 amen. Praise, praise, praise God. Let's
real loud.
It just came back. Amen, amen, amen. One more time. Do you love the Lord tonight? Say amen if you do.
Yeah.
I'm so humbled by this opportunity. To be here. You may be seated in Jesus' name. Don't be afraid to stand back up, though, throughout the service. I think it's safe to say that this is a little different. Amen? We're not in the church house. We're not where we're used to being on Sunday night at 6 o'clock. But I do know that there's a word out there. There's a scripture out there that says Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. So I feel like having church tonight, don't you? Amen. There ain't nothing wrong with a little church, whether you're in the church house or the prayer closet or the town square. Amen. This is awesome. I do appreciate this opportunity. I don't take it lightly to give honor to this church for doing things such as this. And reaching your community, reaching the lost. That's what it's all about. Amen. That's why Jesus came. I give honor to all of the ministry here. I appreciate my family being here. Brother Will has done a great job in carving those other walls. I appreciate all of what you have done over the years. I see my friend Marty over there. Anyway, we graduated together. We're getting old now. It's good to see you. It's good to have my wife, my baby. It's good to see my mom and my sister-in-law come out. And I see a lot of familiar faces throughout the congregation, throughout the crowd. Give honor to all of you. Brother Gray, you're good at what you do, brother. I appreciate you very, very much. We've been around each other a little bit on the Sunday school department. I believe what God is using him to do a mighty work in Marion, Illinois. Amen? Amen. Before we get into the word, I want to give honor to one more person, my friend Kevin Cox. I tell you what, I had a problem with this church for a little bit because we wanted him to stay at Cape. He's a good man. He's good at what he does. He has a passion for souls. And I was joking there. I really didn't have a problem with this church. But y'all have a gem. Amen? He's a good one. Praise God. But I mean, further delay, amen, we'd like to go to the Word of God. And you know what? Let's go ahead and stand. I hate to make you do that, but I believe the Word of God deserves honor, don't you? Amen. We're going to read from the book of Psalms, chapter 46, and verse 1. Amen. Psalm 46, and verse 1. Do I need to do something different here in my book? Okay. How's that? Good? Alright. Praise God. Psalm chapter 46, verse 1. We're going to skip a few verses and go down to Psalm 46 and 7. Psalm 46 and verse 1 says, God is our refuge. And everybody said refuge. He is our refuge. Verse 3, the author says, ravaged by tornadoes, hailstorms, and thunderstorms. We just had storms similar to those last night. Many of you were talking about this particular storm started in southeast Missouri, and it stretched all the way to southern Indiana. At its strongest point, it produced winds up to 180 miles per hour. Its path was 15 miles wide, and it tragically claimed the life of a 24-year-old young man in Perryville, Missouri, which is roughly about 7 miles away from where we are right now. His car was picked up off of the highway and thrown 100 yards into a field where he lost his life. And I think it's safe to say that's tragic, to say the least. His life was just getting started. And that is not only a tragedy, but it's one that is very close to where we live. All throughout that night, my family communicated with each other. We were all on the phone, we were calling each other, we were checking on each other, we were staying at one another's houses in some cases, just to play it safe. I'll never forget how I felt that night. I was just very uneasy as those storms came our way. I wasn't going to be comfortable until daylight was shining the next day. I was up most of the night making sure that my family was safe. I had a live broadcast of the weather warnings pulled up on my phone, and there were sirens going off where we live, signifying the intent, warning us about the storms that were approaching. And I'm thankful. It's obvious tonight. God protected us through the night of those storms, and those storms did die down. But it was the next day that I was reflecting upon what had happened. I was thinking about how grateful I was that my family and my loved ones were indeed safe. Safety is an important thing, amen? I began to think about, at that same time, sitting there on my couch, drinking my coffee, reading my Bible, I began to think about how important those warnings are. I would venture out to say that those warnings have saved lives over the years. I would say that even greater tragedies than the one that took place in Perryville, Missouri, have been avoided because of the warnings that each city or each township such as this one provides. A warning, while it can be scary, is one of the most valuable things that we can have as people when storms like this are raging. Amen. Even though that storm has ceased, it's been since that night that something has been stewing inside of me. I put this in the Holy Ghost this morning. I was praying. I'll be honest with you, I was having a hard time focusing this morning in my office, in the church, in the prayer room as I was preparing for this service tonight. But God just spoke into my spirit and said, nothing is more important to a community, to a church, to a family, than to be safe. And I mean spiritually safe as well as physically safe. Something has just been stewing inside of me since that night that that storm hit Southern Illinois. I've been wondering to myself, when was the last time that we heard a warning about the storms that we face on a daily basis? Since that night, the storms that we saw with our very own eyes, they have backed off. The sirens that we heard, they have ceased. The warnings, they have stopped. But the storm that has me stirred up is a storm that doesn't ever really stop. It's the same storm that Peter spoke of when he said that the devil walks around as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. It's the same storm that Paul wrote about to the Ephesian church when he said, we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. It's a storm that might not be as obvious as a tornado. It's a storm that might not be as obvious as a hailstorm or even an inland hurricane like we've experienced here before. But this storm that I'm talking about and this storm that has me stirred up is a storm that devours and terrorizes mankind until there is absolutely nothing left in its path. I'm working my way to where God needs us to be tonight, but before we get there, I just want to give a warning to everybody here right now. Get to a safe place in the midst of the storms of life. We need to make sure our children are safe. We need to make sure our homes are safe. We need to make sure our families are safe. We need to make sure our marriages are safe. Get to a shelter from the storm that this world wages on every single one of us. Amen. The storm is here. It's not going anywhere. The waves are crashing against our boat, so to speak, and it's getting nasty in this world in which we live. But while the storm is crashing against our boat, we still do have an anchor, and he is still both sure and steadfast, and his name is still Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior, the forgiver of our sins, the redeemer of our souls. This storm that we live in, this storm that we are surrounded by, is scary to say the least. But if we can get to a place of refuge that is provided by God, we can not only withstand the storm, we can defeat the storm. If we can hear the warnings that are around us and see the signs that are around us, we can not only survive the storm, but we can thrive in the midst of the storms of life. Amen. When we look at what's going on in today's world, let's just be honest. It's really not pretty. Amen, if you agree with me. It's not pretty at all. We live in nasty times. Families get destroyed on a regular basis. Then the obvious danger of physical attacks across our country. It's because of these things that a huge debate has been born, not just in the United States of America, but all across our world. In today's society, everyone wonders, what can we do to make our country safer? What can we do to make our homes safer? What can we do to make our communities safer? Different people have different ideas, but tonight, I do believe that we can put the debate to rest, because there's only one way to ensure complete safety in our lives, and that is a relationship with God and having a strong presence of God in every aspect of our lives. The prophet Nahum wrote that the Lord is good and that he's a stronghold in the day of trouble. Somebody hear me tonight. We need a safe place in this time of trouble, and God provides exactly what we need. He provides a place where we can meet the Savior. He provides a place where we can go and just know that no matter what comes our way, everything is going to be all right. There's been some times in my life when I just wanted to say, hey, it might not be good right now, but everything is going to be all right. It might not look good right now. It might not feel good right now. It might not seem good right now, but I serve God. I serve a God of valor. I serve a God of grace, and everything is going to be all right. Amen. What God gives us, and I'm working my way to the point tonight, what God gives us goes further than a place to be at a certain time of the week. A relationship with God, it stands no matter what kind of storms come. We each need to get to a place in God where we know if hell wages war, everything is going to be all right. The Apostle Paul wrote that if God be for us, who can be against us? The psalmist wrote that as the mountains are round about Jerusalem, so the Lord is round about his people. Isaiah wrote that no weapon that is formed against us shall prosper, and that's just a product of serving God. In a day of trouble like today, we need Jesus Christ to be our place of refuge. Our homes count on it, our families count on it, our eternities count on it. If you're a mother, if you're a father, if you're a grandparent, we need to get to that place in God. We need to get to that place in our relationship with God where we can withstand storms that we face. I'm getting to my message now, but before I go any further, I want to make sure we're on the same page. We need a place of refuge. We need spiritual safety in our home. We need spiritual safety in our community. Amen. We need those things. In the book of Numbers, God spoke to Moses about safe places. In the book of Joshua, chapter 20, he spoke to Joshua about that same concept, safe places or cities of refuge. Knowing what the world had become when sin entered the picture, God knew that some type of fairness was needed. God knew that some type of shelter was needed, so that unfair judgment could not destroy mankind. God provided mankind with safe places to shelter them from the elements of an unfair world. There were six cities of refuge designated. They were spread throughout the promised land, so that people who had their lives in a wreck could at the very least find a place of comfort and a place of rest from a world that was out to utterly destroy them. They didn't just choose these six cities of refuge out of a hat or at random. These six cities of refuge were placed specifically so that getting to them might be easy for someone who was in trouble. Getting to a place of refuge might be easy for someone who was desperate for help. And looking to Scripture, if you have time to study it, Matt, please do so. You will see that these places of refuge were placed strategically on the west side of the Jordan River and on the east side of the Jordan River. There were three places of refuge on each side, and the distances between these places of refuge were the perfect distance. They made it possible for someone to find safety in just one day, no matter what they had done, no matter where they had been, no matter what they were going through. They were just one day away from a safe place. If they were on the east side of the Jordan River and they found themselves in a mess, they were just one day away from a safe place. If they were on the west side of the Jordan River and they found their lives in a wreck, they were just one day away from a safe place. If they were anywhere at all in the promised land, they had the opportunity to find a safe place no matter what they had done, and in just one day's time. In some cases, people who likely didn't even deserve refuge walked through these city gates, but while they were not worthy, when they got there, they knew that they at least had the opportunity to tell their story and make all of their wrongs right again. Can I tell somebody tonight that that concept is alive and well? It doesn't matter if you've lived in sin for 40 years. It doesn't matter if you've been a wreck for the last decade. There is still a place of refuge that God has designed for you to get to, and it's a whole lot easier than what people make it out to be. It doesn't matter what your life has become. It doesn't matter where you're headed. It doesn't matter what direction you're going right now. You're still just one day away from the safest place, a place of refuge that God has provided for you. Amen. Can I just tell somebody tonight, if you're listening in the crowd, if you're listening on the square, can I just tell you that it doesn't matter where you've been. It doesn't matter what you've done. It doesn't matter what your life has become. God still has enough grace to go around. God still has enough grace for you and for your home and for your family. And God's grace is still sufficient for the biggest sinner. God's grace is still sufficient for the biggest wreck. God's grace is still sufficient not only for us, but for everybody. Amen. Now, I know that we're not in the church house tonight. This is obviously a little bit different. Let's just be honest with each other. We're not really in our comfort zones right now, but that doesn't matter. God doesn't need our comfort to touch somebody's heart. God doesn't need our comfort to change somebody's life. God doesn't need our comfort to change somebody's direction. God doesn't need our comfort to deliver somebody from the grips of sin. God doesn't need our comfort level to be high in order for His grace level to be high. I know we live in a sinful world. I know we're surrounded by a lot of things that are going wrong, but I still know the Bible says where there's a whole lot of sin, there's a whole lot more grace. There's enough to go around. Are we convinced of that tonight? Praise God. Now again, I know we're not in the church house, but if you're a visitor or if you found your life in a wreck, I want you to know that as soon as you became acquainted with Marion First Apostolic Church, you became acquainted with a place where you won't see judgment. You became acquainted with a place where condemnation doesn't exist. I know this world is crazy. I know this world is messed up. I know out here you may face judgment. I know out here you may get ridiculed. I know this world will use you and abuse you, but just let me tell you what you'll find in the church of a living God. You're going to find the love of God. You're going to find the peace of God. You're going to find in the church, you're going to find more grace than you know what to do with. You're going to find more mercy than you know what to do with. Because when you become a part of the church, you become a part of the refuge. This is where the accuser of the brethren has to stop. This is where conviction wins and condemnation walks about the back door. This is the church. Jesus said that the gates of hell would never prevail against the church. I want somebody to know under the sound of my voice, powers and principalities don't rule in the church. The prince of darkness doesn't rule in the church. Danger doesn't rule in the church. It doesn't matter where you've been. It doesn't matter what you've done. You may have messed up somewhere along the line. Show me somebody who hasn't messed up somewhere along the line. The Bible says that we all have sin in our lives. Your life may be ravaged by a storm right now. I came to let you know in the Holy Ghost that you found a safe place in Marion First Apostolic Church. And just like in the Old Testament, I feel the Holy Ghost right now. All it takes is one day for everything to be turned around. Somebody say one day. Shout one day. The lady with the issue of blood faced her problem for 12 years. Then one day, Jesus made a difference. The man at the pool of Bethesda waited for 38 years before he got his breakthrough. But then one day, everything changed when Jesus entered the picture. It doesn't matter what yesterday represented. It doesn't matter what the last decade represented. I've got news for somebody in this house or in this square. Today is a new day, and today is your day. It doesn't matter what the storm has done. It doesn't matter how late in the game it is. In one day's time, this is where it all turns. Are we good? Devil ain't gonna win this one tonight, all right? There's been times when I thought sound systems were of the devil. Sound man said, amen. Amen. Somebody one more time say, one day. One day in the church can take care of years of sin. One day in the presence of God can take care of years of depression. Years of anxiety can be taken care of in 3 seconds at an apostolic altar. It's just a matter of finding a safe place. And tonight, if you become acquainted with Marion First Apostolic, I know this service is once a year, but what Marion First Apostolic Church has to offer this community goes a whole lot further than once a year. Amen. This church offers a place where you can find safety on a weekly basis. This church offers a place where you can lay your sins at the altar every single time you need to. It doesn't matter. You can ride the altar to heaven. Paul said, I die daily. If you need a place of refuge from the time you wake up to the time you go to sleep, God has provided a place such as this. And it's 923 North Bentley, if my memory serves me correct. Amen. You will find that many of the miracles that Jesus performed, they did indeed involve specific places. They involved specific places that God instructed people to go before their miracle could come to pass. Just by the showing of hands, anybody ever needed a miracle? Anybody ever needed a breakthrough? We've all found ourselves there. So many miracles in the Bible hinged on people going where God told them to go. Many of the miracles involve specific places that God instructed people to go before their miracle could come to pass. These miracles were not going to be found in just any spot along the road. It takes more than 4 walls and a steeple to make a place of refuge.
Right.
Amen. There are specific places that God needs us to get in our relationship with Him. And when we get there, God needs us to do more than just use oxygen. In John chapter 9 and verse 7, Jesus told the blind man to go and wash in the pool of Siloam. When the blind man got there and did what Jesus told him to do, he received his miracle. He received his sight. Jesus told Saul to go to Damascus. And when he did that, he became Paul, the apostle of the Gentiles. Who would have thought that? Jesus told the disciples to go to Jerusalem and wait in the upper room for the power of God to fall. Acts chapter 2 and verse 1 says that when the day, notice how it just took one day for everything to change. The Bible says when the day of Pentecost was fully come, the Holy Ghost fell. Here we are a couple thousand years later. We're still having church. We're still going strong. And while the devil tries to stop us, the storm hasn't been strong enough to keep us from being where we are. I'm convinced that the church is still in good shape, even though the world isn't in real good shape. I'm convinced that the greatest days of the church are ahead of us, not behind us. I'm convinced that there are still a whole lot of people out there who are fixing to be filled with the gift of the Holy Ghost and receive these miracles that I'm preaching about here in just a moment. But before that happens, we've got to get to the place God needs us to be. Amen. In Acts chapter 2 and verse 1, they were in that place that God told them to be, and it was worth the wait that they had to endure, because in one day's time, I remind you, in just one day's time, power was unleashed. In Acts chapter 2, the story was written to put us where we are right now. In one day's time, that promise came to pass, and I feel in my heart, ever since early this morning, God is pulling on somebody's heart right now, saying, go to the church, go to the altar, go to the place of refuge. And God is ready to unleash His power on your life. God is ready to unleash His power on your faith. You'd be amazed at what you could accomplish when you just go and be a doer of the work. It's not rocket science. It's not hard. It's just a matter of getting to where God instructs us to go. And when we get there, do what He needs us to do. I want somebody to know you're just one day away from a place of everlasting refuge. Your safe place isn't rely on anything but getting to where God needs you to be. Amen. God has designed places that each of us need to be. And when we get there, power is going to be unleashed. Anybody wants your home to be blessed? Go. Go where God wants you to go. You want your home to be blessed? Go where God wants you to go. Do what God needs you to do and calls you to do. It's written in His Word. He'll never leave the righteous forsaken. It's written in His Word. He's going to give you everything that you will ever need. He is Jehovah Jireh. He is our provider. Clap your hands if you believe that tonight. My clock says 6:56. We got till 9:30. Is that what you told me? That's what I heard. That and a big diesel truck behind me. Amen. I'm going to stay on this topic for just a few more minutes. We need a place of refuge. Whether we're in the church, out of the church, backslid, on our way there, on our way back, wherever we're at in a relationship with God, we need a place of refuge. I hope there are visitors here tonight. I believe we're on the media, multimedia somewhere. Amen. For those of you who are wondering what it's going to take, for those of you who are wondering what it's going to be to get you to your next level, if you're looking for joy, if you're looking for peace, if you're looking for happiness, it lies at 923 North Bend. Brick building, correct? That is where you can find your place of refuge. And for a brief moment, I would like to talk to those who are members of the church. Something that stands out to me regarding the cities of refuge in the Old Testament. I just want to talk to you about it very briefly. What stands out to me is that these cities of refuge, as far as I can tell through study, these cities of refuge were established places to live before God designated them to be cities of refuge. What I'm trying to say is simply this. These cities had regular citizens before they became places for every desperate situation to run to. That's why, showing of hands, we want every mess to be in our church house on Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Wednesday night. Amen? Amen. The people who were living in these cities of refuge were immediately called to be protectors of those seeking help. I suppose these people didn't have to stay, but when God made these places of refuge, designated these places of refuge, we don't ever read of people leaving. they were immediately called to defend the people who were coming for there to help. And I want everybody to look around. It's a wake-up call. I see some of y'all sleeping. When God designated their city to be a place of refuge, we don't ever read of people leaving. They accepted the call that God had placed on their life. Now, real quick, again, I want everybody to look around. If this is your home church, look around. Look at what you're surrounded by. This is a beautiful place. This is a beautiful place, and God has called you to be the defenders of every single person in this community. Numbers chapter 35 and verse 15 says, and it's regarding those cities of refuge, it says, these six cities shall be a refuge both for the children of Israel and for the stranger and for the sojourner among them. In other words, black, white, red, yellow, purple, it doesn't matter where you're from, it doesn't matter what color, it doesn't matter what ethnicity, this is the place of refuge for you, and your enemy cannot take you out of it as long as we are here. Can I just reach to somebody who still has questions inside about what you can receive in Marion First Apostolic Church? Please understand that when you enter into this place of refuge that I'm preaching about, you're going to be surrounded by people that are going to fight for you. You're going to be surrounded by people who are going to defend you. You're going to be surrounded by people who are going to be there for you no matter what. And as long as you are a part of the church, that is never, ever, ever going to change. That's just what the church does. Amen? Brother Caraway, you don't know what I've done, and you don't know what kind of life I've lived up to this point. Who cares? Who cares? Who cares? The place of refuge isn't going to neglect a single soul. God is not worried about people's past nearly as much as people are. God is more concerned with people's future. And trust this preacher tonight as I head towards a close. God has great plans for every single person in Marion, Illinois. If you believe that, clap your hands. Go ahead and praise God for harvest. If you accept the call to defend the lost, if you accept the call to reach the lost, not just once a year, but every single day, thank God. Praise God. I'm getting ready to close. I'm moving towards a close. And I'm going to bring Brother Gray up here in just a minute. But I want to refer to one more verse of Scripture. The Holy Ghost spoke to Philip in the book of Acts. And my goal here tonight is for the Holy Ghost to speak to somebody about what you can do in God's kingdom. The Holy Ghost spoke to Philip in the book of Acts about helping a man find God. The Bible says, and the Spirit said unto Philip, go near and join thyself to this chariot. This is my favorite part of the message. The Bible says, go and join thyself. In other words, if they mess up, stick with them. If they don't get it at first, stick with them. If they have some baggage, stick with them. The church ought to let the devil know that we mean business when it comes to souls. We mean business when it comes to the church growing, and we don't quit. We don't give up. We're going to pray for people till they come. We're going to help people till we can't help them anymore, and the church of a living God is never going to back down to any obstacle. The church of a living God is going to be there to defend and fight and help and teach and nurture and comfort. We're going to be what Jesus sent us here to be. We're going to be what the church is designed to be, and we're going to have revival because of it. I'd like for everybody to clap your hands as Brother Gray comes. Somebody say refuge. Let's everybody stand up and proclaim to this city, you belong in this church. This is your home. This is where you can find safety. This is where you can find comfort. If you've been searching for something, you can find it in Marion First Apostolic Church.
We could, why don't we again raise our hands and let's just talk to the Lord, church, right out here in the middle of the open. We love you, God. We need refuge tonight. We need your Spirit. Hallelujah. Thank you for this word, God. Thank you, Jesus. God, for allowing Brother Caraway to speak to us tonight, God. Lord, we need this place as a refuge, God. We need it. Lord, this city needs our church to be a place of refuge, God, for those that are hurting, God, those that are lost, those that are hungry, God. We need you, Jesus. Lord, we give you the praise and the honor. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. How many feel the Holy Ghost moving right now? I feel the Spirit of the Lord moving. Listen, if you're here and you're not associated with our church, people have walked in, I know there's been people that have sat, please talk to somebody in our church before you leave. And if church people, if you see somebody around that has been hanging on and listening to these services, go talk to them, invite them to church. Invite them to come and be a part of what's going on in Marion First Apostolic Church. Hallelujah. Before we dismiss, why don't we sing this song together one time? Amen.